Hi, welcome to our session of the Christian Meditation Prayer Group here in St Mary's Church in Killarney. Thank you for joining us online and I hope you're well. Thank you to everybody here in person as well. Nice to see you all. And we will go straight into our meditation preparation. So let us close our eyes, sitting in a comfortable straight back position. Relax the body, relax the muscles. Let go of all the tension in the body. And now we remember that we meditate in the presence of God. That divine presence is with us, underpinning our existence. And so we draw that positive energy into our minds. And then into our hearts. And then into our abdomen. So once again, drawing that energy into our mind. And down the spinal column into the heart. And down again into our abdomen. And one more time, into the mind. Feel it coursing down the nervous system into the heart. And spreading out down into the abdomen. And then as before we begin our meditation, we look with our mind's eye towards our heart. So that the two may unite during our meditation. And then at the sound of the gong, we bring into our mind our sacred word, Maranatha. Okay, everybody all right? Good, everybody okay? Excellent, no catastrophes, no disasters, no fiercely wandering minds and all kinds of yelling out and stuff like that, eh, Dennis? Good, all right. So, we've been looking at our meditation practice in the context of Lent and also looking at Lent in the context of our meditation practice. And I've been exploring some of the ideas at the deeper level for you. And we can take that a little bit further. We can explore. I seem to have left you on a cliffhanger last time. So let's see where we go with it, shall we? The idea behind meditation is to take us into that space which we find ourselves truly who we are. The idea that we take a deeper look inside ourselves. And what we discover there is something very different, something very strange, something we're not used to. And therefore it looks odd, and it looks as if it's not real. This notion of what is real is really quite significant. Because when we actually penetrate deep enough into ourselves and discover what's really going on inside, then we discover a reality more real than real, more real than we think our own life and our experience and the world around us is. And just think about it for a moment. Just think about it. What do we do when we observe the reality in which we live? What do? We look at it, we touch it, we smell it, we feel it, yeah, all the five senses, yeah. And then the brain takes over. So the senses that we have, that we draw in, those signals that we draw in, they have a tangibility about them. But when those signals get to the brain starts to play around with them, yeah? And there are all kinds of things you can do to fool the brain, yeah? And the classic one is to take a pair of spectacles and to have them so that the lenses don't actually invert the image, yeah? A lens always inverts the image, so our eyeball inverts the image. And you can get a pair of lenses that do the same. And what happens is that what's coming into the eyeball is already inverted. So when you do that and you look through, everything's upside down, literally upside down. And it takes a day or two for the brain to work out what to do. And the brain then inverts everything. And then you wake up the next morning, you put the glasses, everything's the right way up. And then you take the glasses off, everything's upside down again. And the brain has to work it out, yeah? So what on earth is the brain doing? Yeah? What is the brain doing with all of that data? There are people who can see something and it smells to them, yeah? Because the parts of the brain that are connecting with our olfactory capacity are actually engaging in the same kind of reaction as the part that looks at vision. So when they see it, it's the senses of the smell that are being activated at the same time. Yeah? Or when you look at a colour, you hear music, because it's changing the way in which the ears perceive things. Yeah? The brain is very complex and very clever. So you can have, as we know from our own personal experience, you can have a difficulty with one eye, and the other eye is providing information for the brain, and the brain takes that information and places it on top of the information that's coming from the faulty eye. So you don't actually see what the eye is seeing. You see what the brain thinks it ought to see. Yeah? And that's what the brain is doing. And we call that real. Who is to say that you lot look like I see you? Who is to say that what I see is actually you? Yeah? Who is to say? Yeah? When I look in the mirror, is it me I'm looking at or not? Is it something else? So, this idea of reality, we are lured into a false sense of the notion of it, what is real and what is not real, and how we engage with that. So the brain is doing things normally to help us, normally to make it possible for us to live. But actually, is it real? Actually? One of the things I've been doing with my scientific research is looking into the ways in which we measure things and how that measurement tells us what is there. And what I've discovered is that when we measure things, we're not actually measuring what is there, we're measuring the interaction between them. Do you know how it is when you get one note playing and then another note that is nearly the same? Nearly the same. And when they play together, what you hear is a very small noise that kind of moves around in that space. It's like a beat frequency, we call it. You know when the aeroplane is flying and the engines are not quite in sync? You get this sound, yeah? And it's the beat frequency between these two. It's not actually there, but you hear it, yeah? And this idea of interactions and what's not actually there, but you see it and you think it's real. Even in science, it happens, even there. So when we're looking at things outwardly, we perceive everything to be real. When we look inwardly, we think, oh, that's odd. What on earth is going on there? But actually what is going on in the spiritual is more real, much more real, because that is actually God. And the appearance of the activity of God in creation. So the idea of meditation then is to take us into that realm. And I talked about it the last time. I talked about this boundary between which things get changed. Yeah? And I think I spoke about it in terms of something is there and then it gets turned upside down. Yeah? And when we look at the writings of the early Christian tradition, particularly Evagrius of Pontus, he writes about this a lot. And the idea is that the virtues, the things that come from the spiritual realm, the virtues, are turned upside down and they become the sins. And that boundary, where does that happen? That's the crucial thing. If we look on this side of that boundary, then what we're actually looking at is not actually real. Not in the spiritual sense, because it's been inverted. It's been changed from what it should be. That boundary, where is it? Where is that boundary? And what is it that's on this side? And what is it that's on the other side? Yeah? So I ask you the question, all right? I give you a moment to think about it. Where is your ego? Where is it? Can you locate it? Have you any idea where it is? No. You know it's there. You can feel it. Yeah? You can feel it. Yeah, you know it's there because it puts ideas into your head. You know it's there because it makes you do things. Like it makes you not able to walk past that piece of cake. Yeah? Yeah, suddenly you feel, oh, I need it. I need that piece of cake. Or in your mind, you're thinking, oh, I have a thought about that thing and I know that's not a good thought to have. Yeah? So two things going on there. Two things. One is the appearance of something being turned upside down and the awareness of it. The awareness of it. And that's what we're doing in meditation and that's what we try to do in Lent. We try to become more aware of ourselves. And the thing to do is, with our meditation practice, it helps us greatly, is actually to find ourselves being aware of that boundary at which things get turned round. Once we are aware of that boundary and we notice things are getting turned round, or that they have already been turned round, we then are able to locate the ego. We can tell where it is. We can tell.
Can we find the boundary though?
Yes.
One day I was grubby and suddenly I have peace beyond all understanding.
Yes.
Now, where does that
right.
one cut thing out of another?
Right. Well, you need the peace to be able to get to look. So when we're in that position.
Yeah, say that again?
We need that peace
yeah.
to be able to get to look. Yeah, so we're not distracted. What happens is, in our meditation, is that we get closer and closer and closer to that ability where we can find ourselves being aware at the deepest level, at the finest level. And when we do that, what happens is we become sensitive to the tiniest movements in deep inside our spiritual, deep inside. And when we are aware of that tiniest movements, we notice things that are happening as they are happening, not after the event. It's no good we're knowing that we've suddenly got peace or we've suddenly got anger. That's too late. It's noticing when it's just about to happen. That's the place. That's the boundary. And that's what we're being called to learn through our meditation. Which is why we have to practice it regularly, yeah, constantly practicing. And finding ourselves wanting to be able to notice those things. Because when you notice them, you notice something really strange. Next week...
But I was talking myself out of it before. It'll be all gone tomorrow anyway.
Yes.
You know what I mean? So
yes.
Why wouldn't I want to keep it?
Yes. So, next week, is St. Patrick's Day. God bless him.
Friday, yeah.
Yeah, next week, next Friday is St. Patrick's Day. So we will be having our traditional Eucharist in our church. So I will post a recording of the meditation online for you. Okay? Right, so it won't be in person, and I will then deliver the next bit. You know, I'll explain to you what I just was about to say. And then the Friday after that is the Wander Wild Festival, and this room in our church is in use on the Friday after that. So Friday the 17th and Friday the 24th, both of those Fridays will be online only. All right? So I hope you will all attend. Our online session, our virtual session, and I will follow through a little bit more. Yeah?
I think so.
Yeah?
Looking forward to the Zoom. Thanks very much.
All right. God bless you all. Nice to see you.
Thank you.
Take care.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.